Good morning, everybody. This is Yann Bedzigli from ISS Addis Ababa. I'm a researcher for the PSU report. And today I will try to sum up for you the outcomes of the 27th Summit of the African Union that took place in Kigali last week. So I will be assisted by Lizelle Louvaudrin, who is an ISS consultant and is working also for the ISS Peace and Security Council report. So I will begin my presentation now, and feel free to ask any question of your interest after I finish it. So, okay, here we go. The 27th Summit of the African Union took place in Kigali from 13 to 18 July. This summit was closed to observers and partners in the line of the decision taken at the summit in Johannesburg last year in 2015. This new formula is supposed to help head of state and government to focus on few substantive questions. In consequence, the agenda of the summit was drastically reduced. For example, there was not any PSC summit at the level of head of state as traditionally. However, this summit can be summed up through three issues: elections, funding, and South Sudan. I will begin by election, which were election to the Commission of the African Union, which were the major issue on the agenda. As you may recall, there were three candidates to the position of chairperson: Dr. Speciosa Kasibwe from Uganda, an ex-vice president; Agapito Mbamukwi, Minister of Foreign Affairs from Equatorial Guinea; Dr. Pelonomi Venson Moitoy, Minister of Foreign Affairs from Botswana. It was uncertain that the election would take place because of a lack of consensus regarding the stature of the candidates. ECOWAS officially called for a postponement and a reopening of the candidacies, but other regions reject this request. So the election took place but was suspended after Dr. Venson Moitoy from Botswana failed to reach the two-thirds of the votes to be elected for chairperson. She gained, in the last round, she gained 23 votes out of 53. The election was then reported to the next summit in Addis Ababa in January 2017, and the submission of candidacy reopened by head of state and government. It is the first time of the history of the Pan-African organization from OAU to AU that abstention shaped a race for chairperson or secretary general this way. In the three first rounds, abstention was where 17 states abstained. The abstention grew to 20 in the runoff and to 28 in the ultimate round. This abstention reflects three major lines of divide. The first one is the dissatisfaction regarding the profiles of the candidate to the chairperson, illustrated notably by ECOWAS, who practically abstained all over the election. The second line of divide is political. There were many states which could not live with a chairperson from Botswana, a state characterized by its very particular stance on the International Criminal Court, human rights, and good governance. And lastly, there were the issue of regional rivalries. Once the candidates of the region were eliminated, most states in Eastern and Central Africa simply abstained. More important, none of the candidates could decisively expand their support outside the region. The respective core of every candidate are very close to the number of states in the region. For example, Dr. Venson Moitoy got 16 votes in the first round. SADC has 10 states. Mr. Agapito Mbamukwi got 12 votes. There are 9 states in Central Africa. And Dr. Kasibwe has had 11 votes, while Eastern Africa counts 14 states. Meanwhile, the abstention of the first round was 17, and ECOWAS has 15 states. These three elements are behind the postponement of the election. They overlap and they are not exempt of contradiction. One would have seen, for example, that Botswana, with its record on human rights and ICC, one would have seen that Botswana, with its record in human rights and ICC, would be logically supported by a country like Senegal. It was not the case because regional solidarity was the critical issue in this matter. And we have to do a final remark about this point is about this issue is the fact that the coalition that elected Dlamini Zuma to the chair of the commission broke up when you compare with the result of 2012. If you just take the result of the first round in January 2012 and the result of the first round in Kigali in 2016, you find a very stark difference. For example, Dr. Dlamini Zuma had 25 votes in the first ballot in 2012. Dr. Venson Moitoy, also from the SADC region, earned only 16. The main difference between these two scores is the support of Eastern Africa that went to Dr. Kazibwe from Uganda. In 2012, incumbent Jumping earned 28 votes in the first ballot. In 2016, Mr. Agapito Mokui, also from Central Africa, got only 12 votes. And the main difference here is the abstention of West Africa and the fact that Jumping was an incumbent and not going chairperson. So I will address now the second issue of this summit, which was the funding. The funding was the major issue of the agenda. Head of state and government retreat in Kigali on 16 July to discuss on this matter, based on a report conducted by Donald Kaberuka, who was appointed high representative for AU fund last January. Dr. Kaberuka proposed an import levy of 0.2% on all eligible imported goods into the continent to fund the AU operating program and peace and security budget. The expected revenues of this new measure are 1.2 billion per year starting 2017. This levy, from the perspective of the Peace and Security Department, this levy is supposed to bring $325 million in 2017, $400 million in 2020. It would be raised from equal contribution from each of the five regions of the African Union. This measure is certainly a stepping stone on the road of self-reliance for the African Union. It will help the AU to reach the goal adopted last year in Johannesburg of funding 25% of the budget of its peacekeeping operation. However, one should remind that AMISOM, for example, costs $1.1 billion per year, so there is still a long way to go. But I would like to do a very short remark about the difference between what Dr. Kaberuka proposed and what the Obasanjo report proposed 2 years ago. Dr. Kaberuka measure is a shift from the Obasanjo report because it is limited on import goods, while Obasanjo report focuses on service. It means that exporters from non-African countries and ultimately consumers will have to pay the bill of AU operation budget. In this framework, member states are exempted for any additional efforts for the moment to fund the AU. And we need to have in mind, because the report is not yet public, that it could be an issue from the perspective of international trade law. Because if you cannot change when you are engaged in a free trade agreement, or even you are a member of the WTO, you cannot change unilaterally your tariff structure. So this is something that needs to be clarified from the perspective of the implementation. Lastly, I will address the issue of South Sudan. In this summit, as I said before, there wasn't any summit of the Peace and Security Council on the agenda. So peace and security issues were not at the top of the agenda of the Trans-7 summit, especially if you compare to what happened in last January in Addis Ababa. However, South Sudan inserted itself on the agenda following the eruption of violence in the country starting July 7, that led to the escape of Vice President Riek Machar and most of the SPLM-IO from Juba. A meeting was held on 17 July by IGAD Head of State, plus UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon, Jacob Zuma, Paul Kagame, Idriss Deby, and Yoweri Museveni. This IGAD Plus meeting adopted the following decision. And the decision was adopted by the Assembly of the Union with a stress on the revision of the mandate of the UN mission in South Sudan to include the deployment of a regional protection force to separate warring parties, protect major installations, and demilitarize Juba. The fact is, until now, the government of South Sudan is strongly opposed to any additional force in the country. It is unlikely that the Peace and Security Council or the UN Security Council would allow a deployment of a regional force without the consent of the host government. If it's sure that additional force willing to engage in risky operation would improve the capacity of UNMISS to fulfill its mandate regarding the protection of civilians. However, it's not certain that the model of the DRC force intervention brigade would fit in this situation. In DRC in 2013, the brigade was deployed in the framework of MONUSCO, was mandated to neutralize armed groups. In South Sudan, where both parties are not committed to peace, it's not certain how such a brigade would fit. Moreover, Question remain about the practical implementation of the demilitarization of Juba. In the current configuration, most elements of the opposition SPLM-EIO have already left Juba. Would the demilitarization mean asking to the SPLA, which is the state army, to withdraw from the capital? Secondly, does it mean that the regional force would be in charge of the security in Juba, assuming some kind of a tutelage of the country? In the current divide inside the Security Council between the P3 and China and Russia, but also inside the AU Peace and Security Council, that often stress the issue of sovereignty, this commitment would be difficult to implement. Finally, it seems that the AU plus the UN are dealing more with the consequence of the crisis rather than the cause, which is the lack of commitment of both parties to peace. Most leverage, such as sanctions, arms embargo, or even the hybrid court to judge those responsible for atrocity, are off the table right now. Therefore, maybe this decision taken by the AU Assembly in Kigali would have a short-term impact in re-establishing security or protecting civilians, but its overall impact on the political situation would be uneven. I think on Burundi, the AU right now, the PSC is very shy because there were expectations that in the decision taken by the assembly, there would be some words about possible sanctions. But after all, the draft in my possession right now, there isn't any real new path of action that was decided by the assembly. It seems that the AU is still waiting for the UN to decide what they expect to do about sending a police force in Burundi. But while people in the AU member state complain about the fact there isn't any kind of progress about the inclusivity of dialogue, right now the AU did not take any new action. The matter from the UN perspective, it's not absolutely about funds. It's more about the format of the mission. Because, for example, you have a lot of the major contributors in terms of assets contribution from the UN are not at ease in funding peace enforcement mission will look more than war, than traditional peacekeeping. So from the perspective, the reasoning is very simple. If the AU think that its comparative advantage is in very strong peace enforcement mission and not in traditional peacekeeping, the AU should carry the financial burden that goes with this kind of choice. So it's not very clear. It will certainly be a leverage because there were a lot of consultation between Dr. Kabaluka team and the UN GPKO. But it's not clear yet how these two issues are related. There was a lot of rumors in regarding a possible attendance by King of Morocco to the summit. Morocco made it very clear through a speech that was distributed at the outskirts of the summit that they would like to rejoin the AU. So there was a communique from the AU like yesterday saying the entry of Morocco inside the AU was never discussed among head of state. However, the so-called communique display what were the steps to get in the AU. So the Morocco would have to present an official request to join the AU, and then this request will be dispatched by the chairperson of the commission to member state. If a simple majority of member states, meaning 28, agree for the return of Morocco, Morocco could be a new member of the African Union as soon as he sends his request. But the communique from the AU yesterday said that the AU Constitutive Act does not have any provision that can lead to the expulsion of a member, because there was some call from the president of Senegal asking for the suspension or even the expel of the Western Sahara Republic from the AU. So right now, the AU just recalled that it cannot be done.